Destroy it, Frodo! Throw the ring into the fire! Go on, now! What are you waiting for? Just let it go!
The ring is mine.
Oh my fucking god, Frodo! You're such an idiot! It's literally right there! We just walked how fucking long? For how long? It's just, this is your one moment to do the one thing! Okay, fuck this, I'm going home.
The branches.
Welcome to the Soyle Podcast. I'm Tom L.C. Ship.
I'm Jack Gleason.
I'm S.K.
And we're going to be talking about epic stories, which has heroic heroes, which do amazing things. They kill dragons, they slay beasts, and they travel the land. And then there's other heroes that aren't as impressive.
And how most of the time the main character is not the one who's doing the impressive thing. Anytime you've left a movie or a book and you went, man, that was a really cool thing when that guy did this thing, and it's not the main character, those are the stories we're talking about.
So.
I don't understand why when we do something like this, someone just can't look up the definition of an epic and then just use that. Why do we have to try and redefine epic? Then why didn't you do it?
Because I didn't know what we meant by epic.
I'm reading the definition of epic poetry right now, and this would have sufficed.
Well, go ahead.
A lengthy narrative ordinarily involving a time beyond living memory which occurred, the extraordinary doings of extraordinary men and women who, in dealing with gods or other superhuman forces, gave shape to the mortal universe for their descendants. Oh my god.
Comes from Latin, from Greek, epikos, from epos, word or song.
So, since we're all dying to talk about it, why don't we just start with fucking Lord of the Rings?
Usually, though, what we're focusing on is a protagonist who is probably going to start in a very low status, or not as a king, or somebody with a lot of power.
Yeah, it's typically the hero's journey, is what we're talking about, right? Because that's the form that most epics take. As we follow one character who initially doesn't want to go on some sort of epic quest, right? They're constantly trying to fight to return back to what they consider normal, and they can't. So, you know, it makes sense for them to kind of be the person who doesn't want to do anything cool. The antagonist, the person driving the plot, the person who is making the epic shit happen, they're the ones who are really doing the stuff. They're doing the big world-ending event or whatever, and the protagonist just wants them to stop so they can go back to farming or whatever.
I think there might be like two different kinds of call to adventures. First, there's like the willing call to adventure where it's like, you know, you're Indiana Jones, you get called up university, you're like, you gotta go get the Ark of the Covenant. He's like, bam, I'm in. You know, Lara Croft style. But then there's like, the burden falls on the protagonist, where it's like, Frodo inherits the ring from Bilbo, and he doesn't have a choice. The burden is thrust onto him. And so his call to adventure is his whisk away to adventure. He doesn't really have a choice.
But as we all know, one does not simply walk into Mordor, so they needed somebody who was gonna be
sneaky.
I'm gonna
slap you in the teeth.
Somebody who's going to be a child, basically, who can sneak behind little enemy lines without being noticed.
Put him in a fucking trebuchet and, like, vault him into Mordor. If they could get fucking fling him far enough, they could throw him right into Mordor.
They have giant eagles. They could have just rode the giant eagles into Mordor. I mean, they might have seen them, but if they all were on giant eagles, his fight. I don't know.
Yeah, just sacrifice the entire giant eagle race in one bomber dive into the mountain.
How high do you think those eagles could fly?
Pretty damn high.
I have to pick them off the mountain.
Surely. They could fly high enough where they wouldn't be seen on approach.
And their medieval weaponry wouldn't be able to hit them.
Exactly. The only thing the Nazgul. Yeah. But if they aren't seen...
I mean, you know Frodo's going to be like, I can't resist. I have to put on the ring.
Yeah,
but if he never put it on in the first place and it took him 10 minutes to get there... It wouldn't have been a big deal. But again, this is a prime example. Frodo wouldn't be doing anything. The eagles would be doing all the work. And somehow Frodo's still the hero of the story.
It's true. It's a good point.
You notice how Frodo can't do anything. You notice how Frodo can't be the guy that solves the problem. It's all about the endless muscular men or giant creatures all around him.
Is Sam also a giant muscular man in this scenario?
He's a titan among the fucking...
Amongst the three people who are there at the end?
Yeah. He might as well be God himself.
Yeah, he doesn't give up hope. Frodo kind of does.
Samwise, yeah. More like fucking Sam Yoked, dude. Compared to Frodo and Gollum, come on. The potatoes alone.
It seems that Frodo's advantage in that story is that he is unremarkable, so he is able to slip
meekness.
By.
That's the entire point, is his meekness, his weakness. Nothing about him is stellar. And that's why if the ring corrupts him, it doesn't really change anything. It would just make another Gollum, essentially. And Gollum wasn't really that impactful to begin with either, so that's why they just let the ring keep corrupting all these little fucking idiots.
The main idea behind the ring is that it preserves what the wearer values most, but then by preserving it, it kind of, you know, transmogrifies it into this kind of unnatural thing. If you have powers of defeating the great armies of Mordor, you're probably going to change into like a giant killing machine that's not going to be good, because it's ultimately going to wind up destroying itself. But Bilbo's first act of mercy in sparing Gollum's life when he first finds the ring shows that his value was in mercy, and it's in that preserving that kind of like sanctity of a peaceful life or something. And I'm not quite sure if Tolkien had that conception of the ring back then, but that's what the meaning took on, at least in Lord of the Rings. So by being a pacifist, Frodo and Bilbo are able to conquer the ring in a way and become the true Lord of the Rings.
Just makes me think of that, of people saying, like, you know, if you're a pacifist but you can't do any harm anyway, you're not a pacifist, you're just harmless or whatever, right? Like, I'm butchering the... the hobbits being pacifists. I don't know. Is it really based on them, like, making that choice? Or is it just they couldn't really do much anyway?
I don't know. They didn't get a chance to, like, raise a dumb little army to fight against the forces of Mordor.
Well, the point is, about Lord of the Rings, is that Frodo doesn't do the cool stuff. Anything besides get stabbed.
He does have a chance to, like, kill Gollum, so he chooses mercy. I don't know if that counts as a cool thing, but because it's not like, you know, the hero slaying a beast, you know, it's the hero.
I still would argue that Sam would have been much, much more apt to kill Gollum instead if Frodo hadn't been merciful. But, you know, I guess in the long run, if Sam had killed Gollum, then Frodo would have been corrupted by the ring and Sam probably wouldn't have killed Frodo. And then we'd have another fucking 100 years of dumb fucking idiot running around with the ring.
Dumb fucking idiot.
I'm just saying, look at the Lord of the Rings and you look at all the cool shit that happens. Oh, does Frodo fight the Balrog? No, that's Gandalf. Does Frodo become the king of men and raise an army of ghosts? No, that's Aragorn. Does he die an epic death? No, that's Boromir. He doesn't do anything. He walks. Three fucking movies of just walking and complaining. And just Elijah Wood looking, with teary eyes, the whole fucking movie. All three movies just, it's so dirty, and I wish we had more of that elven bread. But Gollum threw it off the cliff because Gollum doesn't like normal food. He likes to eat fish guts. And Sam, you're looking so plump and juicy without all our food around. We gotta cut a piece of that meaty calf off and fry it up.
Juicy hobbits, how does it taste, precious?
Sam's the champ. Sam Wise. Bro knows what's going on. He carries that little fucking idiot Frodo up that fucking mountain because, I'm too tired. I've run out of elven bread. I can't walk another step. And Gollum's like, you could give me the ring. I think it'd be a little lighter if I was carrying it. And Sam is the only one who's like, does anyone else see this fucking hairless thing trying to take the one thing we got to destroy? Who's clearly Sam an knows. Asshole.
He knew the whole time.
Who's tried to kill me multiple times by sleep.
Sam knew he was going to wait for them, you know, at the end when Gollum was going to jump out. He knew. What is it? Gollum, like, sneaks up behind him and knocks him out first and then goes for Frodo when they're inside the volcano.
I think he gives him a meaty thwack with a rock. Yeah.
You're saying Sam knew, even though he got his head beat in?
He let it happen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
To prove a point.
So, this reminds me of one of my favorite war movies. It, as opposed to like a movie like Saving Private Ryan, where the character has a very, you know, vigorous and active role, there's a story called All Quiet on the Western Front, one of my favorite books. I forget who the author was, but the character is basically kind of a pacifist. He's going around, you know, wander, you know, like the colors of the landscape in the fronts of World War One, I believe. And when he's given the chance to fight, he's like, he's either not shooting or he's shooting into the air because he comes across like dead bodies and he's just horrified by it. And he almost spends too much time on like the artistic qualities of like the dead body and the landscape. So he's kind of a great protagonist because of that. He's maintaining onto some kind of like innocence or mercy through, you know, literal hell. So it just stands out as opposed to, you know, Tom Hanks going in guns blaring. So he's not a soldier who's doing a bunch of epic shit. He's just trying to fucking survive. He's not, you know.
Well, all right. To be clear, when I came up with this topic, it was more of an observation than it was the shit on the heroes. I think the purpose of the hero not doing all the cool stuff is so that we can be embodied by the hero, because it's like, we wouldn't probably be able to do any of that, all the cool stuff that everyone else is doing.
It also has to do with, like, how do you define cool in the first place? Because, like, some people will talk about, like, the big, you know, explosion or whatever, right? You know, you have all the idiots who go and watch the Fast and the Furious movies.
Wow.
Yeah.
They just fucking... If you enjoyed a Fast and Furious movie, check your intelligence.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
I mean, you can say the same about the Avengers and, you know, all those superhero movies.
Where is this coming from? I didn't know that you were elitist in this department as well.
I'm elitist in all departments. You should know this about me now.
I assume that there was some humanity behind the mask, but I guess not.
The point is, the explosions and like, grandiose movements of plot... these are all things that a lot of people will focus on and will go, oh yeah, that was the super cool thing where, you know, this crazy shit happened, right? But I think there is something to be said about the coolness of a character given the opportunity to do something like that and then choosing to take the much more difficult and moral path.
To yes, maintain their values. During peacetime, you know.
it just sounds like you're leading up to, it's cool to not pick a fight. It's cool to say no to bullies. It's cool.
You know nothing, Jon Snow.
When someone says, hey, meet me outside, we'll fight at 3 o'clock after school. And you say, you know what? No, my mom wouldn't want me to get dirty after school. It's cool to be clean.
Is it the Hamlet complex?
Sort of, but not quite that.
That's why I said I felt like you were going that way.
I mean, like, you could have, like, just taking one of your examples, right, of, like, the bully or whatever. In my example...
Oh, you're going to take my joke as an example and then deconstruct it? No, yes. I don't think so. We're gonna segue real quick here.
So what you do is you go and meet the God. Bully anyway, right? But instead of
you talk
harming them, maybe they try to harm you and you...
Pull a big prank on him.
Wow, okay.
Drop pig's blood all over them. They're so embarrassed. And so psychologically scarred, they don't have to fight.
There are
That's
other
a story
methods,
people are going to remember.
Exactly. Well, pig's blood would probably be another flashy thing. But, you know, you can...
A bucket of water, then.
Whatever it is. You know, there's other ways out of the situation that are not necessarily violent.
And again,
or
to be clear, the point of this is not to shit on the hero. I think that winning the moral battle is the most important thing, and the hero should do that. But my problem with the Lord of the Rings is that Frodo doesn't win the moral battle. He's a fucking... idiot. Frodo doesn't win the moral battle. He doesn't make the decision that actually saves anybody.
Well, there's almost the rule of the like an enabler, like in a book like Heart of Darkness or Apocalypse Now. So the whole story, you're following the protagonist as he journeys down the Congo River to find this, you know, the famous Kurtz, who's done so many renowned things in the ivory business, you know, getting that ivory from the Africans to Europe, to England specifically.
Yeah, boy, get that ivory.
And along the way, he's hearing the stories of what Kurtz has actually been doing and growing in the darkness of his heart and like taking over a village and then killing a bunch of people and then cutting off everybody's hand just to show his dominance over them. And then he comes face to face with the man and he just listens to him and then he leaves. Because he's like, his mission, I believe, was to get Kurtz back to England. Or like, you know, just find out where the fuck he is. And like, you know, report back. And he's just like, he is a monster. I'm going back. The hero doesn't do anything, but he goes on this epic journey. And it's like, what was the point of that? Other than showing the darkness that another person is capable of while you do nothing.
Right.
It almost seems like too pacifist. Like, that could be a bad thing. Like, it's enabling it. Like, Luke Skywalker, you know, he faces off with Darth Vader and the Sith Lord. He's, you know, he's taking an active role.
How many people really like Luke?
I feel like you're just trying to stir up trouble. Luke blows up the Death Star. He actually did that.
Yeah.
That was the big thing. Shot. That was like the one thing everybody was trying to do. It's like, oh, Han Solo, he shoots all the troopers. He does all the stuff. Ooh, wow.
R2-D2's but Luke actually a real
blows
hero.
Up a fucking giant Death Station. A gun that kills planets.
With the help of Luke's R2-D2.
Like, ooh. Oh, yeah, R2-D2.
He's like Sam. Hero. R2-D2 is the Sam to Luke's Frodo.
Now, since Tom brought up Star Wars, I wanted to just kind of briefly mention the opposite of what we're talking about, the Mary Sue. These are the main characters who, they do everything. They take up all the screen time. They do all the cool stuff without ever earning any of it.
Born perfect,
okay,
you know.
I was gonna say, this is, we're talking about the new trilogy then.
Yeah.
I was going to say, because Luke gets his hand cut off and he gets fucked up. There's a lot of shit that happens.
He earns it, yeah. It's like, as opposed to unearned greatness, which is the new trilogy.
She gets forced tortured, which leaves no scars and leaves no psychological damage either.
Everybody gets forced tortured. You know, Han gets forced tortured. Leia gets forced tortured. You know, everybody's getting a little bit of the pie.
The pie?
Force torture.
At least when Darth Vader did stuff with people, he killed them.
God, yeah. Like, there you go. That's a good example of a fucking cool character. Everybody's surrounding Darth Vader.
All the cool shit.
All, like, rearing to shoot him, and he's like, all I see is...
all I see are dead men.
Yeah. He just fucking goes and kills everybody.
That's because Anakin's good. Anakin's fucked up, and he's powerful, but he deserves it. And he's also the Antichrist, which is kind of cool, too.
That kind of reminds me of another story, a manga anime called Monster by Naoki Urasawa. And it's basically about, I don't want to give too many spoilers, but basically there's a kid, and there's a doctor who's the protagonist, Dr. Tenma. He saves the boy's life, but then the boy grows up to basically be a kind of antichrist. So the protagonist, he first gets framed by Johan is the antagonist, and then he has multiple chances to kill Johan, but he always is either stopped or he feels too much of a moral kind of stop, and you know he's not doing anything. But like meanwhile, around him, it's basically another Hitler is rising to power. There's this power in like choosing mercy, although it might not be the cool war thing, you know?
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. But I think the distinction is that you have to be presented with the opportunity, you know, commit that crime, essentially, that moral crime, rather regardless of if it's a legal crime, but the moral crime, and then choosing against it, especially against some sort of, you know, deep struggle of character. If you can overcome that and still choose to do the good thing, that is absolutely like an epic thing. And so... here we go. I'm going to bring up a story that I don't think anybody was expecting me to bring up, except for maybe you two, but...
Frozen.
Specifically Frozen 2.
I knew it! I knew it!
There is a scene in Frozen 2, spoiler for Frozen 2, if you haven't seen it, where Anna believes Elsa is dead, and she just watched Olaf die, and she's alone in a dark cave. And it's very depressing, but she works through it and you know decides that you know she can't like wallow in it and decides to move forward essentially and not really think too much about like what life will look like after this because it's too painful to consider you know a life without the people that she cares about. So she's like, the only thing I have to think about right now is like the very next action, essentially the next step that I'm going to take. And I think it's really a powerful scene. And I think it's a really good message for somebody dealing with intense grief. And I think that is in a way a very cool and heroic thing to do, even though it has literally no effect on anyone else but yourself, until of course you then go and actually do something after you've worked through this. But it's still a psychologically and emotionally epic thing to be able to accomplish, is kind of getting yourself out of that really intense despair. So I thought that was a really good example of something where it's not the cool and epic thing is not the violence, it's the opposite. Right.
Right. It's not turning into the monster that it could have turned them into.
I think another example that fits would be Fullmetal Alchemist, specifically Brotherhood. The main character does do some cool stuff, but he doesn't do the coolest thing, which is become a literal god. So there's that.
Well, yeah, the villain's got to do the biggest thing. How else do you establish stakes?
Exactly.
If your hero does the coolest thing in the story, flip it. Make them the villain. Otherwise, you like them too much. Why the fuck are you doing this?
So that's the thing. That's why the main character can't really do the cool stuff because otherwise they would need to be the villain.
Let them rise to their level, but don't let them be the coolest guy in the room. Let them be the most moral in the room.
Now, another example where the main character does do the cool stuff, or a lot of the cool stuff anyway, would be Breaking Bad. But as we all know, Walter White is not the hero.
And you can tell from the transition. When he starts doing all the cool stuff, he's like, oh, man. Now Jesse's the hero. Because in the beginning, you know, when he's fucking Ned Flanders, and he's getting beat up by everybody, and everyone's all, oh, you're so fucking old. What are you, like, 100? And he's like, 50, please. I have cancer. I need to make meth. And then he walks around in his underwear like a fucking goon. That's not a cool guy. Barely moral.
Yeah. More, you can empathize with him more, though. I feel like we can empathize with these because every other character in the
story is a drug dealer or Skyler.
Skyler.
I don't empathize with any of those people.
It's like these heroes that we're talking about, I feel like they're more true to life because not everybody's going to be Schindler in World War II. You know, not everybody's going to be going to the wardrobe in the Chronicles of Narnia and, you know, fight in an epic battle. I feel like they're going to be more like the just trying to survive whatever burden is thrust on them.
Schindler was like a piece of shit too for most of his story.
Wow.
He was doing it for self-preservation.
Yeah,
and then I'm just saying if you watch the film Schindler's List, he's kind of a dickhead the entire movie until the end when he realizes, wow, I could have done more. And that's sort of his awakening, his realization that he could have been even better than he was. But he was too busy being a fucking playboy, banging all of his secretaries, training guns for money and money for booze.
I need to rewatch.
I'm not saying that he didn't do good things. I'm just saying that
it's not a Mary Sue.
Don't tell me he wasn't personally driven to live a good life during the war.
What role is more empathizable? Are we Braveheart or Frodo? I feel like I'm more of a Frodo than a Braveheart, personally.
Well, that's kind of the point, isn't it?
I think there's a difference between, like, an epic hero who's supposed to represent some kind of greater moral message and a folk hero who's supposed to embody the spirit of a nation.
Ah, yeah, that's true.
What is Jon Snow? Does he fall under?
An idiot!
So, Frodo idiot?
Jon Snow is worse to me, honestly.
Why?
I don't want to be king.
Because he sucks.
King
Frodo Bean. Does, you know, as good as you can when you're 3 foot tall and you never raised your fist to anybody except to hold a beer. That's all Frodo does. They live in luxury. They drink and they have a good time, and then Uncle Gandalf comes by and has fireworks every once in a while, and it's like, oh, great.
Sends you off to an adventure.
Why don't you go into the dangerous part of the most dangerous part of the world and carry this fucking super ancient relic that's going to corrupt you for sure if you decide to put it on. It's shiny, by the way. Don't put it on. Don't
basically
do it.
Sending them to their death.
And Jon Snow is like, I'm a bastard. My life sucks. Let me go to the wall so I can hang out with my Uncle Benjen. And then he immediately disappears, and he makes friends with Sam fucking worthless Tully. Tarly? Tully? Which Tarly. One is he?
I feel like
Sam Tarly.
If anyone could have stopped Daenerys before she did all of her worst shit ever at the end, I feel like it could have been Jon Snow, and he just kind of didn't challenge her.
Yeah, lots of characters tried to stop her. They all got burned to death.
Jon Snow, I feel like he just kind of bent over, you know? He just had too much of a Hamlet complex. He waited too much, and then it just shit went out of control. If he just acted earlier, be like, I'm the actual true king, and I banged you as my family member.
Well, you know,
you know, if they could just turn off the part of his brain where they decided, okay, here's... You know what your character is now? She's your queen. That's it.
Live your entire life.
Every action is dictated by the fact that she's your queen now. Because loyalty has gotten you so far. Everyone you're loyal to, look at them. They're all dead. And now you gotta kill your anti-girlfriend?
I mean, the Hound is pretty cool.
Are we just looking for good things to say about Game of Thrones?
I like the cinematography.
Yeah, it's all pretty good for a while.
Yep, and then it's not.
So that concludes this week's Soyle podcast. Please reach out to us, touch us, and love us. We are your friends, your lovers, and
are you really ending your it children?
Right now? SK, do you have anything else to add? Because I think I'll go ahead and wrap it up. If not,
no.
All right. Well, on that note, I think that's a good place to wrap up. So leave a like, subscribe, leave a comment. You know, if you have any other examples about stories where an epic story where the protagonist just doesn't do the coolest stuff, let us know. See if we can if there's any that we missed. Anyway, that's about it. Thanks for watching.
Can I get a little more high energy?
No.